Almost 50 years ago, my dad flew on the Concorde. This was a supersonic airliner that could fly from New York to London in only 3.5 hours. That same flight today takes nearly double the time at 7 hours. Can you think of another piece of tech that has actively gone backwards over the last 50 years? It's kind of crazy to think that we used to have the dream of supersonic flight, but it's kind of faded away, or at least it has until today.
Boom Supersonics XB-1 aircraft is the first passenger jet to go supersonic since the Concorde was retired in 2003.
United Airlines buying 15 supersonic jets from a small upstart aviation company in Denver called Boom.
Welcome to the Mojave Air and Spaceport, where the plane behind me is going to fly supersonic for the very first time. So this is the Boom XB-1, and the concept is that this is an experimental jet to develop the technologies needed to build the Overture, the first supersonic airliner for almost 50 years. Now, I want to be clear that this video is not sponsored by Boom. They were very gracious in giving us access to not only see the XB-1, but also talk with a lot of the people behind it. But what really gets me excited about this is that this is a look at the technology that we've simply lost over the years and that is going to, with any luck, help us fly much faster in the not too distant future. All right, so they're taxiing out right now. They're about to go down the runway. This is so cool. In fact, I'm whispering. I don't know why I'm whispering. Everyone's getting excited, waiting for it to happen. Here they come. Here they come.
In the pilot's world, we say that if an aircraft looks right, she'll fly right, and XB-1 certainly looks right.
Why did you even start this? I'm just so curious, I'm kind of like what the path was to get here.
It didn't stand up to a simple analysis that anybody with a spreadsheet and web browser could do. You didn't have to do that much better than Concorde. They hit a tipping point in affordability where the market would be big. And so I remember thinking that this is very bizarre. Like, how could like I be the person that like stumbled over the unlock formula for supersonic passenger flight?
I don't think anyone could be opposed to the idea of improving air travel. But the question is not so much should we do it, it is much more so, can they actually pull it off?
So let's take advantage of this and just watch XB-1 on her takeoff roll as she leaps into the air for the first ever supersonic flight of an independently developed civilian supersonic aircraft.
Wow, that was fantastic. Doesn't she look gorgeous?
Wow!
Especially when the gears
are... Is it true to say you have the most amount of hours on the Concorde out of anyone?
Yeah, I've got the most. Tell me I've got the most amount of hours on Concorde and consequently most amount of supersonic hours of anyone in the world.
So, that's amazing. So how long did you fly the plane for?
22 years.
Wow.
And right up until the very end, I flew the last scheduled flight in 2003.
Really?
Yeah.
What do you think went wrong with the Concorde, and why do you think that we've had such a sort of gap in supersonic flight when it seemed like it was the future, right?
It was born just at the end, really, not long after the end of the Second World War, when the driving force was technological. Can we do this? If we can do this, let's go do it. Of course, these days, the driving force is not technological, the driving force is financial. If we do this, will it be profitable?
The Concorde really was a truly incredible aircraft, largely thanks to an unlimited supply of money from the British and French governments to actually make it happen. The question wasn't, should we do it? The question was just, how do we do this at all costs? And while ultimately there were only a small number of Concorde planes that were ever actually built, it was an incredibly impressive piece of engineering. And incredibly, it still is the fastest passenger jet that has ever flown. And it did that for over 3 decades. Now, the question might be, why not just bring the Concorde back? But there were a ton of problems because it was a very limited aircraft in that it was using military jets of the time, which were unbelievably inefficient, and it made these tremendously loud sonic booms, which meant that for pretty much the entire lifespan of the Concorde, it was only able to fly transatlantic from the east coast of the United States to various spots in Europe, mostly the UK as well as France, which really limited the possibilities of what was otherwise the world's fastest aircraft that could only fly a handful of routes.
When it went into service in 1976, from that point forward, for British Airways, Concorde was profitable. Most people don't think it was, but it was. It earned about £500 million in total real bottom line profit for British Airways in the years it was operated. That's when £500 million is a lot of money.
And being profitable is key, because this is not a project that is being funded with an unlimited blank check from a government. This is an actual company who need to design, develop, and ship an aircraft that is not only going to make them money, but importantly, also going to make the carriers money.
But unfortunately, it was becoming more and more expensive to maintain. And that's fundamentally what the root cause of causing the retirement was. But now with Overture, it's a totally different thing. Firstly, we've got a lot more knowledge and a lot more capabilities after all that time. Secondly, it's driven by a different motive. We want to build an aircraft that is accessible to everybody, that enables people to fly around the world, to make connections, to do all the business, and make it accessible to more people.
One of the things that Overture theoretically will be able to do is also fly over land. As of right now, in the United States and many other countries around the world, it is illegal to fly above the speed of sound over land for fear of sonic booms, which back in the 70s and 80s were tremendously disruptive. However, the Overture team have actually developed the XB1 as well as the Overture with the idea of actually eliminating sonic booms from hitting the ground. The XB1 program is largely actually designed to help test this tech, where essentially the sonic boom will rotate itself back up and dissipate into the atmosphere before it actually hits the ground. Meaning that, assuming that the laws were allowing it, would allow you to actually fly supersonic over land, which would not only open up more routes, but importantly, allow you to make things such as New York to Los Angeles even faster than it is before.
It's proof of capability, it's team building, it's leadership, and it's getting the right people to buy into this and make more and more people realize that supersonic passenger transport is a possibility once more, and not just pie in the sky.
So I think it's worth putting in context what XB1 is, because this is a test plane. This is essentially a 1/3 scale of the actual final Overture plane. And what this has been designed for is to prove the technology, prove the fact that the aerodynamics work, prove the fact that the materials work, and to try to gather as much data as possible that they can use to put into the development of the actual Overture.
So, the challenge was, a small, scrappy company design a clean sheet, supersonic capable airplane that's never been done before. It's been done by governments, it's been done for military projects, but it's never been done with a small team like that. So the challenge of designing a supersonic airplane really is that it looks the way that it does because it needs to go fast. But every airplane, regardless of its top end speed, has to take off and land on the same runways. So just because your airplane's twice as fast doesn't mean you get twice as long of a runway to take it off on, right? The challenge is kind of like designing two airplanes at once. It's like you have to have a slow airplane that behaves very well when it's taking off and landing, and it also has to have that top speed performance. That's why it looks the way that it does, is to perform those two missions, basically.
Would it be a fair way to kind of say that, like, sort of half of the reason that you built the XB1 is to learn how to build a plane, and the second half is to gather data for Overture? Is that maybe like kind of a little bit of the sort of the idea? Kind of like, how do you think about
that? I would say it's like 80% learn how to build a plane, how to build a team that can build a plane, and maybe 20% learn how to apply things directly to Overture.
This is a fascinating answer to me, because if you think about it, the last time that a supersonic aircraft was designed and developed in the United States was 20 years ago. It's not like you can just go ring those guys up and say, hey, can you give us a hand? So much of this XB1 project really is about developing the technology, but also developing the know-how to build something that quite simply hasn't actually been done in 50 years. It's one thing to build a small single or two seat little jet that's meant for military uses. It's a very, very different problem to design an airliner that is going to carry 30, 40, 50, 60 people or more. For Overture, there are a huge number of parts that need to be specifically designed for the plane. Engines are one of the most complicated and expensive components of any aircraft. And the two biggest manufacturers of airliners today, Boeing and Airbus, actually don't make their own engines at all. Instead, they rely on third-party suppliers, such as GE and Rolls-Royce, to build the engines for them. And this task is especially more important when it comes to flying at supersonic speeds. But for Overture, Boom have embarked on a mission to build their own engines. Now, there are practical benefits to this. They can develop the engines to be exactly tailored to the model and the mission for Overture. They can be the right size, the right power level, all that kind of thing. But the biggest downside here is that they're taking on enormous risk, not only financially, because these are enormously expensive to build and maintain and develop, but the big thing is, if and when things go wrong, it is entirely on Boom's shoulders. But let's take a closer look at the technology, the plan, and what it's going to take to turn this test aircraft into the real deal. How do you feel when you step into a test plane to do something no one has ever done before? Like, damn.
It's real cool to have this opportunity. I remember this one in particular, like the first time I got in this jet. I remember climbing these stairs and like getting in and like kind of looking around like, whoa. They're not really gonna let me do this, are they?
There they are. Wow. It's actually, bigger than I thought.
Yeah. I expected it to be really kind of tiny and cramped. This is actually, I'm not going to say comfy, but actually not bad.
And it's not too bad, yeah.
I feel like I've only been in a couple of sort of more narrow sort of planes, and they're all much older. And like, you can tell this is, you know.
It's brand new.
Exactly,
it's only flown
yeah.
12 times. Once we put you in the sim, you'll get a lot more out of it.
It's incredible.
Welcome to the XB1 simulator.
Thank you so much.
So this is Jason Reckenecker.
Hey, how's it going? Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
He is the one who made all this magic happen, and this thing is it's a fantastic training device. It replicates XB1 like as faithfully as we possibly can, and it flies just like XB1, and it's all thanks to this guy here. Cool, you want to give it a shot?
I would love to give it a try. Can I give it a try?
Yeah, let's do it.
Excellent.
This is Jason's baby.
Incredible.
He's very proud of this, as he should be. This is what I use to land the airplane.
Okay, all right. Wish me luck. Pulling up. Okay, 180, and okay. There we go. I am airborne, and wow. So you're really relying on this display. You can't see hardly anything forward of the plane.
Yep.
Wow. Okay, we're flying. Oh, that's way too high. Whoa, hang on. Wow. It's actually like quite a lot of movement to kind of try to control. I feel like it's not like these little subtle things. Like you really have to be super focused on trying to keep it as level as possible. Wow, that's, should I slow down a little bit, or is this, are we just chilling?
Nah.
Okay.
No, this is a supersonic jet.
All right, I'm supersonic. Time to land it. This is, I feel like, where it's gonna get a lot. This is very nerve-wracking.
Pull them all the way back now.
All the way back?
Yep.
And then, that was not good. That one didn't feel good.
It wasn't bad, man.
Did the plane survive that? I landed.
It did, actually.
Did it really?
The landing gear can totally handle that. I've never done it to the plane, but.
Yeah, of course. But you know, theoretically, if some numbskull came in and landed too hard. Awesome, dude, thank you so much, man.
It was a real pleasure, yeah.
Test control, you are go for Excel to Mach 1.1.
So this is the really exciting part. Watch the Mach number in the middle of the screen.
There we are. XB1 is supersonic, faster than the speed of sound. We've got confirmation from the control room that she is supersonic. What a wonderful achievement.
XB1 is traveling so quickly that a distance like that between San Diego and Los Angeles could be covered in just a mere 10 minutes.
So this is the second to last time that the XB1 will ever fly. So they've done a number of test flights up until this point to make sure that things are generally functioning. But today was the very first time that they pushed it supersonic. They're only going to fly this thing one more time in the next week or two to fully test the aerodynamics and fully test what it's capable of. And that's it. This thing's going to go in a museum somewhere. And the full focus of the Boom Company is going to be entirely around building Overture, which is the airliner version, the final product that this is all meant to lead up to.
So I've always thought that supersonic passenger travel would come back. I've been waiting for the day. It's taken a little longer, but it's coming, and that's why I'm really delighted to be involved.
That's amazing. And this is a simulator for Overture.
Yeah, so this is a simulator of the flight deck for Overture, and it's got a lot of what the Overture flight deck will have.
Much like how an F1 car is extensively modeled and simulated before it ever turns a wheel on a racetrack, the same is true for an airliner. When it comes to Overture, Boom have spent a lot of time developing this as a simulator for not only YouTubers like myself to give it a try, but importantly for pilots and for testers to actually learn more about the characteristics of the aircraft, especially because some of these systems are incredibly complicated. Take the idea of landing. In a normal plane, you just look out the windshield and you can see exactly where you're going. And because of the shape of the nose to actually go supersonic, you just simply cannot see whatsoever out of either XB1 or Overture when it comes to coming in for a landing, which is why they both rely on a camera system to actually show the pilot exactly where the plane is flying, because otherwise you'd be going entirely blind. You know, a system that might make sense to do some simulations for, to practice with before you build it and fly it. It's nice to know where you're going, unless you're gonna Ricky Bobby it down the runway.
Oh my God, help me!
It is incredibly cool to try these simulators, but ultimately they're just that, simulators. The real thing is going to require an enormous amount of work, engineering, testing, and ultimately safety certification to go from concept to reality, which is why I wanted to sit down with Blake, the CEO of Boom, to understand how they're going to actually pull this off, and is it feasible? Because this is all great, this is all fun. It's great to build a single XB1, but that's a very, very different task than building an airliner that thousands, if not millions of people are going to fly on every single year. What's next?
What is the game plan? How do we get to Overture?
Yeah, so I mean, I think we are, by analogy, we're climbing Mount Everest, and today we're at base camp. And so the next thing is the XB1 team and the Overture team reunite and become the single team working to deliver the airliner. And so it's full speed forward on Overture.
So can you walk me through at least the estimated timeline and sort of what you see sort of the future of when someone may actually be able to buy a ticket, jump on an Overture, and fly supersonic?
Yeah, well, our goal is to welcome the first paying passenger in 5 years.
That seems incredibly fast.
Well, I mean, not that long ago, airplanes were developed way faster than
that. That's true.
So if you look back in the 1960s, where, you know, we didn't even have computers, but we could design airplanes far faster than it's done today. Everyone says 5 years seems so fast. I think the real question is, why in the world does it take so long?
Yeah. Well, safety. Like, I'm just assuming like the processes were different back then, but also the technology is different now.
It's true, but we have a lot more data now. We really ought to be able to do it much faster.
Yeah.
But there are, there's certain things that do take time. Steps that have to happen serially. Safety testing is a big deal. We're not going to skip any steps.
Yeah.
There's no guarantee we'll hit that timeline. But I've come to believe the way to get something done the fastest is to set ambitious goals,
yep,
and then have rigorous engineering reviews along the way, and don't step into building something until we're confident we've got it right.
Yeah. Next, I was able to experience their brand new factory with a VR headset. I'll say that I'm really glad I got to do this VR experience, because it's one thing to see photos of a little bit of a weird looking plane in the Overture, but it's very different to see not only how it's being constructed, but more importantly, what it looks like as sort of a real one-to-one scale in VR. The only downside here is going to be how long it takes and whether or not Boom can see it through before something derails, because there are going to be tons of speed bumps along the way to go from this single test aircraft to a finalized production aircraft that you can actually buy a ticket for. This has been a phenomenally cool look. It's something that I feel like we really need again. The fact that Boom are here to try to actually bring the technology of supersonic flight back that we had in the 1970s, that we've lost, is incredibly cool. And I think especially like looking at what Overture is going to be, it gives me a different perspective, because I think after spending all day with XB1, it is cool and there's so much there, but Overture is a completely different beast. And when you look at the complexity of the design, you look at the technology involved, not only just with the simulation tools and the materials and the computation that is sort of going into that, the advancements in engine technology, I mean, how can you not want to ride? How can you not want this to be successful? Like, so cool. It is just, this is one of the coolest things I've done in a long time.
Well, Austin, it was a real pleasure hanging out with you today. Thanks for coming by to see us. We got this, this is a coin that flew on board XB1 today when
it
we
did,
went
really?
Supersonic for the first time
oh my
today.
God. Thank you so much, that's incredible. Dude, thank you so much. This is unbelievably cool. Wow.